Cheryl worked at Debbie Diner, who did, you know, again, kind of, I think it was their initiative that pushed them to do what they were doing this year. It was a great experiment. I think they have very supportive administration to help them do that. But they're going to talk about what happened with them this year.
Okay, so those are a lot of words. We have two very wordy grants, but basically, we're going to talk about both of them together. So I'm Cheryl Morgan.
I'm Debbie Diner.
We teach fourth grade, and we team together at W.W. Robinson. And I wrote a grant, the incredibly long title, A Community of Authentic Learning, Investing Every Stakeholder in Cross-Curricular Project-Based Learning.
And I wrote a grant, Snap Circuits in Interdisciplinary Project-Based Learning.
But the big idea was we needed these grants to supplement a larger project that we were implementing this year, in that we were authoring our own year-long project-based curriculum for our classroom. So we went to the edge of the cliff and we jumped off. So we went into 100% project-based learning this year. And there's a lot of misconceptions about what that is. So we're going to talk about that today. There's a lot of people that watched that movie yesterday and I think legitimately didn't realize that there was a lot that they weren't showing in that movie, which is all of the mini lessons and instruction that went into all of those projects, which is still part of a project-based learning classroom. When you go to project-based learning, you're not just doing cute little projects all day. So we're going to talk about project-based learning, but I know that this county has a project-based assessment cohort, so I just wanted to talk a little bit about the difference between the two so that we knew what we were talking about today. Project-based learning is the vehicle through which the content is acquired, whereas project-based assessment is the vehicle in which the content mastery is assessed. So those are two different, very different things. Project-based learning can be formative, always. It can be summative, doesn't have to be. Project-based assessment is always summative. So you're looking at two different purposes there. With the project-based learning, group components and individual components are often assessed or evaluated or looked at, whereas project-based assessment, especially that done for the DOE in replacement of our SOLs, has to be individually done. So there is a big difference between what we're talking about and what the initiative is coming down from the DOE.
So the question that always comes up is why change everything you've done to this new sort of method of teaching? And we're going to repeat stuff that has probably already been said in our other problem-based, project-based presentations. But the number one thing is that it's real and it's authentic for the students. So a lot of standards, especially in math and things, which before had seemed really contrived, like you have to learn this because you have to learn it, suddenly have a real purpose behind them. And that makes it much more motivating for the students, and it makes them have a reason why they want to learn for those students who don't just want to learn naturally. It links all the content together. We, I think, are especially lucky in elementary school because we teach everything, so we get to link everything. So we have language arts, Virginia studies, science, and math all in these projects, which, again, links them more to the real world because in reality, you're not going to sit down and just deal with one thing at a time. It's going to be a lot of things linked together. And it gives the students sort of a sense of ownership over their learning because, again, they know why they're learning it. And the answer is not just to take a test at the end of the year. For us, PBL was sort of a natural culmination or growth out of our collaboration. Ever since I was a first-year teacher, I was paired with Ms. Morgan, and we started with STEM projects, and we did a lot more STEM projects, and then we said, well, let's just go full on into project-based learning.
Okay, so what we did this year, we taught all of our SOL standards for fourth grade in nine units, nine projects. That's what we did this year. So every unit that we taught had standards from all four content areas. And they were connected by a larger purpose, something that they had to accomplish. That's, of course, the most important part. That's what lends the purpose to everything they're learning. When they're learning rounding, we can say, you need to know about round this afternoon because you're going to use it when you make your map scale. Everything that we teach them, we have a purpose to tell them. And that has made a huge difference. Every unit has a real audience. That is a component that is often left out. And it is one of the more important ones. Because again, I know we heard yesterday, and when we watched the movie where they talked about the expo. Having a real audience gives them a real deadline and real motivation. We've had some people from outside, we've had older, we have high school students come in. You know, they don't want to look foolish in front of another audience, but you know, they don't actually care as much what we think, you know, but they really care what everybody else thinks. And we have content from all four areas. They are set on their master's skills and content, both individually and through group work. It's not just group work that's assessed, and we'll talk about how we assess that here in a minute. And we remediate them on skills throughout the unit. We had standards-based grading in history, science, and math, because those were the easiest ones for us to tackle while we were writing our own curriculum. And we saw incredible improvements in those three areas. And we really feel like that's because the way that we kept track of things showed us specific holes, and we could remediate those holes specifically. We didn't look at a test grade anymore. We looked at, oh, this kid would have gotten an 85 on the test, but they didn't know anything about this one standard. So we were able to hit those weak points easier.
So sort of taking you through a sample unit, we followed the same basic structure for each unit. We would start off with our, what's called the entry event, so like the movie that Christina showed that gets the kids really fired up for the project. For this project, it was making sort of an atlas or maps of Virginia, and we did a job orientation for cartographers. They got a little name badge and a job orientation folder, and I sat down and watched an orientation video, so trying to get them really excited to start the project. After that, we do the project and mini lessons sort of at the same time. So our daily schedule, we would have language arts in the morning, which was pretty standard language arts instruction, guided reading and all that. We would do math, pretty much standard instruction, guided math. And then in the afternoon, we just had project time. And project time would usually be some sort of mini lesson in Virginia Studies or Science, whatever we need for that day. And then a project task. So, okay, we talked about the regions of Virginia. Today you have to do math. That's the regions of Virginia. So taking what they're learning in the mini lessons along the way. So it wasn't like 2 weeks of lessons, 3 weeks of do the project. It was all sort of split up and mixed together. When you do that entry activity, you always start with the guiding question or driving question, which tells them what their role is, what they're going to make, and who their audience is. And we always have that posted up in the room so that they can keep that in mind. And anytime I would notice that they were sort of getting off track with the project, we'd go back to that driving question and say, okay, what are we? What are we trying to do? And who do we have to do it for? So these are the standards that were covered in that first unit. So this was the maps unit. We have Virginia Studies, it's mostly geography standards. We brought in natural resources for science, because that's what naturally fit in, try to make things make sense. For math, we did all place values, so again, we did rounding and like skip counting by hundreds when they were drawing state maps to scale, things like that. And then on the next page, that's all the language arts. It gets the same page.
Which is why we didn't have our standards-based grading done for that this year.
Because we research communication, that's all the standards for pretty much every project, because they're always researching. So there's a lot of stuff that repeats a lot.
So we're going to move into grading.
So we had talked about how we did standards-based grading. This is what that looked like. We came up with a rubric for each project. But it wasn't just a project rubric, it was a unit rubric. So it wasn't just like, you did a comms project, you sort of did, you didn't at all. It brought in all the knowledge and skills that you would need to have to show mastery of the things for that unit. So we broke it up into emerging, the basic level knowledge that we need just to access the contents, like vocabulary, prior knowledge and things. Proficient, we took from the curriculum framework from the state, looking at what they expect students to be able to do with these standards. And then the advanced is usually some sort of application. A lot of times it's explaining the writing. So I can explain why I needed to round or something like that. And then we have a scale across the top so we can transfer that into the number grades so that we could still get it into the grade book.
The grades that are listed are the only grades we gave. So we didn't give anything between a 93 and a 100. We gave 93 or 100 based on their mastery of the material. It just simplified things. It was either a full check, a half check, no check. And so that way it made the numeric
And if you look, this is where the individual and group comes in. Some of those checks you can get through group work, through working together on your project, but some of those checks came from exit tickets. So yes, you answered the question right on the exit ticket, or no, you didn't. That different
test.
Did you get
to still give tests? Yeah, we give less tests, significantly less, but they're still there because they still need to know how.
Yeah, and those test questions can address things there, and that's where we can see the holes. So if we see, okay, well, Willie did the project, but did not get these questions right on the test, he doesn't get that check. Now I know to go back and hit that with him again.
Okay, so we're going to move into the two specific grants. So the grant that that I wrote for community involvement. So we took a look at what we had available around us, and we realized that we have a wealth of resources here in Shenandoah County. It's just not always easy to access those resources. So we decided that we wanted to really work to reach parents, and we really wanted to work to reach our community resources, either to bring them in or to get students out to them. So we really wanted to focus on doing field trips, bringing in local experts, and doing a parent night to bring the parents in and get them involved, especially considering this was something that was kind of new for a lot of families. So we have, we said, our 9 units. So I'm going to go through these 9 units very quickly and just hit on what our community involvement was for each unit. The ones that are underlined are the ones that we had to take for, so those are the ones that came from the grant. So for unit 1, we did an atlas collection. And that went to another school in Savannah, Georgia. And we had Mr. Hahn, who was a parent, come in and talk about GIS mapping with the kids. For unit 2, we did a natural history museum on the early history of Virginia. My husband came over from high school, which, if you know my husband how he feels about elementary school, that was a very big accomplishment. So, but he brought his kids over, and that was quite a good experience. We enjoyed that. So unit 3, we did protected areas for endangered species, and we had the Friends of the North Fork come in and do a presentation at the beginning, and then we had Mr. Lanen and Mr. Walsh, who are local community members, come in and be sort of our critical friends feedback for their presentations and to give feedback on how to best change and adapt their ideas. For the James, we did an archives on Jamestown, and we actually took a field trip to Woodstock Archives, which is in the library. And they showed them what kinds of things were stored there and how they were taken care of. Unit 5, we did a music video and about colonial life. And we had a bunch of school resources in that case, which we really did try to access those, especially within the other different schools, so that the kids knew what was out there when they got older. Ms. McKee, our guidance counselor, came in. Ms. House, our music teacher, did a great unit with the kids. They helped compose. They composed their songs. So they didn't just write the songs, they composed the music, played them on the recorders quite beautifully. And we also came over here and we watched the orchestra practice so that they could see what sort of went into the music program over here. Unit 6, we wrote graphic novels about the Revolutionary War. And we did 2 things with that unit. Paul Steps, he's a graphic artist, Strasburg? Came in and did an amazing talk with the kids about artwork. And we also went to Triplet Tech, where Paige Cross worked with our kids in the culinary department, because we talked a lot about how women were cooks during the Revolutionary War, and we talked about capacity and math during that time, and so then they took that capacity measurement and they took it to Triplet Tech. Used it to cook an actual colonial recipe. So that was pretty fun. Our Civil War movie, which is the one most of the kids remember, we filmed the movie and we used our grant then to go to Huntsville Civil War Park so they could film on location at a battlefield, which they got really kicked out of. And we had Stephen French come in, if those of you who know him, to talk to us about screenwriting, and then we had another person come in and those reenactments. And then the Unit 8 World's Fair ride is addressed by Debbie's grant, so we'll talk about that one later. And then Unit 8, we have Mr. Snyder, our art teacher, as our expert. What's very interesting is, at the beginning, when we told the kids that an expert was coming in, they thought that we were going to be dressed up in costume pretending to be our experts. That is what they expected, right? And so when, about halfway through the year, we would start a project, they would start asking, who's going to be our expert?
Right? So are we going to get to go somewhere?
Are we going to get to go somewhere? So they right away, they change their minds. They realize that we don't have everything. That they have to go out to the community and they have to talk to people to learn. So parent involvement, we had 5 parent nights. First was parent information night, where we explained what project-based learning was, how we were going to be grading, how this was going to be different. We had a lot of questions and a few reservations, which I understand. We had the evening where they got to come in and experience their Jamestown archives, where the kids had made worksheets for the parents and they had to use the archives to find information, and that was interesting. Our music video release party, we had a red carpet movie premiere, and we had our final celebration at the end of the year. Oh, and I'm sorry, that wonderful picture is of all the juice boxes we purchased with our grant money. We purchased food and drinks for our parent nights, and we felt crazy going through the food line with an entire cart of juice boxes. We used them all. Right. Okay, so both the field trips and parent nights really successfully linked the curriculum with the projects. The students, like I said, right away realized that they needed to go out to the community. They needed to talk to people to figure out what they were going to do with their projects. This is a picture of them at the archives. This is Mr. Zadepsky. Okay, they soon realized that, they very soon realized that I was not going to be their expert on artwork. So we brought in, that's actually, he drew that on the blackboard while it was there.
Yeah, the kids never forgive you for erasing it.
Yeah.
And you erase one little guy at a time until there's one little guy left. Yeah. And I took him away and they never forgave
me. But what you showed them was how when you have a character, you have to look at them from all angles. You have to know what they look like from behind, look from the side. And in some of their graphic novels, they took those skills and we saw them. We saw scenes in their graphic novels where all you saw was the back of someone's head and something happening in front of them. I mean, they really took to heart what he said. Probably way more so than if I had tried to tell them anything about art.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This is us at Triplet Tech. This was probably their favorite field trip. But the kids, the high schoolers, were unbelievable. They were so great with those kids. They walked them through everything. Those kids did almost all the cooking. They did the peeling and the chopping, which as a teacher makes you a little nervous, but they did a great job and they did everything and they got to eat their product at the end and they had a great time. And this was the archives evening where their parents are sitting there working on their worksheets, having to go through. They had a student's diary that the students made about an original Jamestown settler based on their research. And then they had an online collection. So they had to go through both to find primary and secondary sources to find the information. This is our red carpet movie premiere. So we actually had our movies that the kids made shown at the Woodstock Community Theater one night. And so the kids got to walk the red carpet and get pictures taken and get interviewed, and then watch the movie.
Yeah. So. Which goes to show that sometimes you just have to ask. Because we were like, there's no way. But I called NASS and they said, yeah, no problem, and it so you just have to ask sometimes, because we got to do things this year that I would never have thought.
Because we asked.
Because we asked.
And then this is from our final parent night. These projects are their independent study projects. So we finished our curriculum early this year. I've been teaching for 16 years. That's the first time that's ever happened. But with having everything combined, we got through everything faster. So we got to the end of the year, and usually in top fourth grade, you finish Virginia Studies, then you teach all the sciences. You haven't been able to teach for the last month because you're finishing Virginia Studies. But we were done. We had taught everything. So the last 3.5 weeks of school, we were like, well, now what do we do? So we turned it over to the kids. We said, write your own driving question. Come up with your own audience. Decide what you're going to research. Do your own project. So what we have here, we have one project on cows. That's the one on the far left. The one in the middle there is a Pokemon they designed. The one in the top right is my daughter's. But they did a little exhibit, Smithsonian exhibit on extinct animals. So that's the museum exhibit there. And then on the bottom right is recipes. Yeah, they made us try, and then we had to rate on the rubric. So they presented these to the parents, and then they also had made these, which are information. There are handouts too, which I have in here somewhere. But they made handouts and trifold on how to take PBL into the summer. So when you're on summer vacation, what are some topics you could learn about? What are some audiences that you could use? What, you know, where could you go? What resources could you use? And they had that up to present to their parents and talked about how to take this into the summer. So challenges that we had. Well, we didn't get our first field trips in or our first parent nights. Well, we did our first parent night thanks to our lovely administration who paid for a translator for us and all that stuff. But it was hard because we had planned to start out of the gate at the end of beginning of October. We couldn't. So and I know everybody dealt with that challenge. But when we have units, well, we can't do that field trip at another time. So we had to throw out a couple of the early field trips that we wanted to do. And we also, I don't think originally people realized that our field trips went to the end of the year because our units go to the end of the year. So we had to have our budget extended past the normal deadline, which they were great about, but there was a little bit of miscommunication in the beginning. And getting amounts from transportation, I'm not entirely sure still how much money we spent. Because getting those amounts and getting the exact amounts is incredibly difficult, but we can't plan the next field trip until we know how much money we've spent. But the bus drivers don't turn in their things until the end of the month. So trying to figure out how much money we actually have to spend, I still don't have the exact number of how much we spent. So that was a little frustrating. But in all, it was an amazing experience. We were very concerned about what we're going to do without the money that we have this year because it just brought some really great resources to the kids to enhance their projects.
Alright, so that takes us to my grant. My grant was more specifically focused on one of our units, which was the electricity unit. So I wrote a grant for Snap Circuit. When I was doing the research for the grant, looking up studies, all the studies that I found pretty much boiled down to kids learn science better if they can do science. So in order to learn electricity, you have to be able to do things with electricity. You have to be able to manipulate and experiment with it. And electricity is really our standard that if you don't have proper materials, you can't fake it, right? You can't finagle electrical things. That's not gonna end up well. So I wrote the grant specifically for snap circuit rovers, which are sort of the basic snap circuit components, but it fits on top of a little roving vehicle that's remote control. And the reason why is because our project that we were doing this with was what we call the World's Fair ride. It was sort of it's a small world after all style ride where it would take the rider, which was our wonderful administration, through Virginia in the 20th century. So where it starts in the 20th century and then you see all the industrialization, the improvements in technology and the new jobs, and then you end up at the end sort of in modern times. So we wanted the little rovers so they could make little moving models that would go around this part of our ride. So the successes that we saw, main one again is having that practical experience with the electrical components. I mean, I felt like I understood electricity better than I had before when I broke them out of the box and started playing with it. I was like, oh, this makes so much more sense now. So I know that they felt that way too. And they really had a wonderful time. When we first pulled them out, we had diagrams they had to follow, and then they could choose different projects from the book if they had some free time, and just learning how to read the diagram, why you need a diagram of a circuit so you can make the circuit, really brought things home for them, a lot, I think. Another big success is our geometry connection. In our big curriculum framework, we had linked up geometry with this unit, mostly because I was thinking, parallel circuit, parallel line, you know, there's going to be some vocabulary that goes well. And they ended up finding connections that I hadn't even thought of. Like, we talked about closed and open circuits, and then later that week we talked about polygons and how it's a closed shape, and they were like, oh, closed, like a closed circuit, it's all like looped up. Like, they totally haven't. So seeing that connection was really successful. And then again, the motivating factor. I mean, we got these about halfway through the year. This was our second to last unit. So those snap circuits shut set up my shelf for the whole year, and every day the kids come in, are you doing those today? And every time we start a new unit, they'd be like, oh, I remember this is the snap circuit unit. So by the time we actually got them out, they were like,
ow. Well, I had a student, this was when there was the accident with the bus, right? And there was traffic backed up. You need to get to school. We're doing snack surveys today.
So the way that we did the actual project was they followed the diagram in the book to make the basic working rover go around. And then they had to build something to sit on top of the rover to represent whatever their topic was. We had railroads as a topic, coal in Tazewell County, you know, changes in transportation, all those things. Technology changes was one of our topics, so one of the groups created a little crank phone to show how technology is improving, so this sat on top of the rover.
Also and a garage project, so
it sat on top and they could make it, you know, go back and forth. For the actual ride, we had them set up in the hallway. My class was sort of on one side and Gordon's class was on the other side, and then we gently and carefully pushed the principals on a chair through, and so when they got to their part of the ride, they could, you know, they'd move around.
Any feedback on how you experienced this ride?
It was a lot of fun.
we were very pleased that you were willing to sit through the whole thing.
Yeah, and on the next slide is just a couple more. Finished project. The left is a train. So they're trying to get another carriage onto the back of the train and trying to figure out, well, the rover isn't strong enough to just pull it, so are we going to get wheels on it, that sort of thing. And then on the right is a car that they built around the rover with a little guy driving it. So things that we had a little bit of trouble with was mostly setup and management. So when we got them, we actually ended up getting more than we had originally planned because they gave us a bit of a discount. Very nice, but we had all these snap circuit rovers, and they're all, none of them have batteries in them. They all have a bunch of pieces that I was immediately like, they're, I don't want to lose any of these pieces, and I don't know how to make sure I don't lose any of these pieces. And then just managing it with the students, making sure that they know how to take things out of the box neatly, back into the box neatly, and everything that we want to do so we can keep these for next year. And then when they're actually using the rovers, there's remote control, so there's three RC channels, but there's a lot more than three groups going at once. So every once in a while, you have one group testing, and another group like, our rover's blessed! So they had to get really good about only turning on their rover when he said, yes, now you can test, no, now you have to turn it back off. And they did well with it, but it was so overcome these difficulties, I was really lucky to have a wonderful parent volunteer who came in one day and said, what do you want me to do? And I said, I want you to take everything out of this box and label all the pieces and put everything back. And then get the next box and label, put it
back. Leave it back for 3-4 times. Yeah.
Yeah, so each box had a letter, and then all the pieces in that box got the same letter. And then she also labeled, if you can see the top right, the tray with what piece should go in each section of the tray. And it was helpful because I did have one group that lost a piece, and I was easy for me to tell that they had lost a piece, and they're very lucky that they found that piece later.
Okay, so we went into this year, and we really, really hoped that what we would do would work, but we didn't know. We didn't even know if we were going to get everything done in time. So it was a bit of a nerve-wracking year for us. But we took a look at our overall, we looked at a lot of data, really. If we start with reading, they had averaged together, we had 43 students. They had a 72% pass rate in reading, and those same students had a 67% pass rate in third grade. All but one of our students, though, that had 200s in third grade made it up to the mid or high 300s. And that was a big handful of students as well, so we were really proud of their progress. And we had, of our 15 students below grade level at the beginning of the year, reading out according to their running records, there were only two at the end of the year. So they did make progress. In math, they had a 65% pass rate in third grade and an 86% pass rate this year. We call this the unintended math effect. We really went into this going, well, we've linked math. Okay. but really all we felt like we were doing is when we were teaching the math in our same guided math traditional way, we would just keep saying, don't forget you need this afternoon. Don't forget you need to use this afternoon. That was like our only difference.
Yeah.
And the order, we changed the order to link up with the project. So there was some stuff that was probably in different order. And all year long, our math tests were higher. Their performance on the SGA was higher. But I said, you know, this could just be, you know, who knows? We'll see how this plays out at the end of the year. And then again, at the end of the year, they did amazing. And we did not expect that.
We didn't change math.
Because we didn't really teach math that much. But we taught it with purpose. And that was really the only difference, is that we gave everything that they learned a purpose. And it was unbelievable, the difference that we saw just in them, in how they interacted with math. And in history, we had an 85% pass rate last year. We had a 93% pass rate this year. We had three kids fail. All three kids failed with 3 9s sometimes. So, I mean, they did an amazing job in history. Let's see. Reading, of course, we've examined that number a lot. Because I'm not entirely happy with that number. It was the only subject that we didn't use the standards-based grading. So, to us, those numbers speak pretty loudly. So, guess what we're going to have to do over summer production? We're going to have to go back to that really big curriculum map, and we're going to have to attack that. We're going to have to do what's best for the kids, which is obviously breaking that down by standards. Now, we gave a period of survey and a student survey at the beginning and the end of the year, so that's what we're going to talk about here.
Yeah, we wanted to get sort of a feel for how their views on learning and school change during the year, if they change at all, if they change positively or negative way. And just a couple of things that we noticed when we compared those beginning and end of year surveys. Starting with the parents, there's that question, what does it mean to succeed in school? And at the beginning of the year, grades was usually the first thing mentioned. A lot of parents also mentioned, you know, liking school, being confident, but grades was definitely there. They want to know that their grade is high grade means that you have learned. Whereas at the end of the year, grades were mentioned some, but usually at the end. And first it was things like, I had more than one parent say, my student comes home and tells us about it, and they teach us about what they're doing in class, and that means that they're succeeding. So I definitely saw a shift.
I had a bunch of parents that mentioned both the beginning and the end of the year that they would like more information about how their students learn best, which is not one of the things that we did in our parent nights. And so as we look at going into our parent nights, so that's something we can easily continue next year even without the money. There won't be as much juice, but I feel like that's something that we can make an effort to include for next year.
And then looking at the student surveys, which had questions like, how do you feel if you get a question wrong? Do you like taking tests? Do you like answering questions in class? We noticed a big increase in growth mindset, especially in those lower academic students. The higher academic students, I've always felt it's kind of harder to get them to the growth mindset because they're so used to being successful with their fixed mindset that it's harder for them to make that switch. But the lower students were saying really positive things about failure at the end of the year, they were saying, it's a flaw, you can try again, things like that. And also just in general, I was amazed by how much articulate the students were at the end of the year survey than the beginning of the year. Where in the beginning of the year, we had multiple students who just answered a question nonsensically. Like the question was, what is your favorite thing to do in school? And their answer was yes. Like just not something that even makes sense. And at the end of the year, they were writing full phrases or almost sentences, and just seeing that how much more use they were to thinking about their thinking and thinking about their learning.
The unintended math effect played out here as well. Many of my students, and I had a, people are gonna probably ask us about our student population. We had everything from special ed to GATE. But my class was a little bit skewed lower than Ms. Steiner's, and the majority of my class put math as their favorite subject in the year, which I was like, where did that come from? Many of them who had it as their least favorite subject. So it was unbelievable to see that switch. And a lot of students were no longer embarrassed to answer the teacher. Well, it was a question like, how do you feel about answering the teacher's questions in class? And they were no longer embarrassed to answer the teacher's questions or miss a question because they knew they would just try again. So I have a couple of the students' actual answers here. What does it mean to fail at something? No one really fails if it was your best. Nothing else matters. Another one, let's see. What does it mean to fail at something? It means to make a flop but not learn from it. Instead, give up. How do you feel if you get a question wrong? Okay, why? Because you're not always going to get things right. It's a flop. You'll have a revision. Those are obviously vocabulary words wrong. What does it mean to fail at something? It means just try again next time. And then this one, criteria being this one. What does it mean to fail at something? Not believing in yourself, just giving up. So anyway, these are really special kids. the difference that we saw in the way that they felt about themselves and their learning.
So the big successes that we saw this year, just how students perceived schools.
Really, my phone, by the way. It was the first time I felt like I was teaching again. I wasn't teaching material for a test. I was teaching them information because they needed to know it. Because they actually did need to know the first battle of the Revolutionary War in Virginia, which at no other point in their life have they ever needed to know that. So it was just, it was fun for me. And it also increased our awareness of the individual standards. I mean, I have looked at those a million times. But to go through those rubrics, to make the rubrics, and to design the rubrics, and then to meet the kids on them, I mean, I know them upside down and backwards. I mean, the large educational community, we presented at a couple of conferences, and we had a county, which county came and actually sent some administrators and teachers to observe, which was exciting for Shando County, I think, to be, you know, a county that other people wanted to come see. That was exciting for us.
So challenges and next steps, starting with those rubrics. I had such a love-hate relationship with those rubrics because they are wonderful and they tell you so much about the students and they're such a meaningful way to grade them, and I just hated them. Like, I hated looking at them and checking them all off and going through, like, I just, she knows because I complained about it all year, but we have to keep them because they worked and they changed the way we taught, they changed the way that we planned because we could see exactly what things we need to do. So we're going to try to update the format of rubrics a little bit to make it easier, not actually official, but easier for me to make sure everything's getting on there in a timely manner. And also make sure it's easier to share, because these were all just hard copies. And it would have been so much paper. We originally were going to think of, oh, send a copy home with parents, keep it, but it was just so much paper that we ended up not doing that. So what we are hoping to do is with this new gradebook update, sort of transfer them into the gradebook in a way so that it can be immediately accessible to parents and students and easier for us to keep track of and not have so many papers just around. And also reading, we already talked about, we want to go to standards-based grade for the reading. So we're working right now on coming up with checklists for each sort of big skill, like cause and effect, author's purpose, to see what basic knowledge they need to have, what do they need to be able to do to show they're proficient at it, and then what would be the advanced level.
Yeah, and all we have now is basic outline, and we're already really excited.
Yeah.
It's already giving us more form to our instruction. We've had concerns about their transition to fifth grade from the students themselves. They said they don't want to go, they're worried. They're used to this PBL and they want to keep doing it. Parents have the same concern. And then some of the fifth grade teachers were a little concerned, you know, are they going to come expecting to do all this? And,
are they going to be able to sit still in the afternoon? They have to sit still in the afternoon for a year.
No. And we're trying to find the best way to honor those concerns, but to also know this is what we're going to do because it worked. So it's very hard for us to find where that balance is, and we're not probably quite there yet, so we're still thinking about that. Local experts, you know, what are we going to do when we don't have the money to fund up? So we haven't solved that problem exactly yet. And we'd like to develop a mentorship for project-based learning. People who want to start putting units into their curriculum. We already have some. We have two primary teachers at W.W. Robinson who approached us and are interested. We have a few other teachers at fourth grade who asked about doing some of the units. So, you know, we've got our feet on the ground for that, but you know, it's a really overwhelming process. We would not have done it by ourselves. We would have drowned.
You need
so, you need to have somebody. So we thought, you know, maybe not everybody has a teammate that, you know, they're friends with and they're willing to spend 3 hours a night on Google Docs with. And so we thought if we made ourselves available as a mentor.
Building, they learn that things don't always go their way and they have to try again and work around. which is from one of my gifted students who do not always see that. So I was really proud of her. And then I really liked this quote. It has, the student put their research into making a project that showcases what they learned. This is good because then the student will know how to put their research into a real life situation, which I did not tell her to say. She just came up with that. So I was like,
mine aren't as pretty because I'm dealing with mostly people that were below her level at the beginning of the year, but they said just as wonderful things. Let's see. I think you should do PBL in the future because it's fun. You take us to places like the Battlefield Archives and Harriet Tubman plays. So they can remember what they did and the details for help on the SOL. They wouldn't want to just look at textbooks. Projects are fun, and it gets people who don't cooperate to cooperate. And another one, do you think we should do projects next year? I think we should because it's so fun building them. We don't only build, we just got done making a movie. It's still educational, but it's not getting really exciting. Plus, you can be really creative too. It's a way you don't have to just remember, you can actually see it. You are still learning, it's not boring because the other classes are just breathing, but projects are awesome. And then if you forget about this unit, you can just look at your project. So that's why I think we should continue projects. So,
and my personal favorite essay I got was, no, you should not compete PBL next year because it makes students think really hard and they don't like that. That is the best response, I think.
They're like, when? So the biggest lesson we hope our students would learn this year was that learning is not an SOL test. An SOL test is a measurement of learning in one way on one day. Learning itself is a deeply personal, lifelong process that's filled with mistakes, challenges, and diverse accomplishments. Watch what they told us when we asked them what they learned this year, and you decide if we were successful. And I know some of you have already seen this, so I apologize to those people. And I also apologize for the fact that this time I'm going to cry.
Peace. And
you can't tell on me because he doesn't know this, but I totally played it off like, oh yeah. Because they said, oh, you want me to come in and talk about my work on the Endangered Species Act? And I was like, oh yeah, that's totally fine. Here we have somebody in our community who worked on authoring the Endangered Species Act. Like, I mean, that's, you know, this is what we have available to us in our county. We just have to put the word out. People don't know that we want them.
There's been a couple comments back here about publishing. Have you all ever considered publishing this?
We did. When we did our research passage, we did do everything,
reuse.
Yeah, reuse, just in case. But honestly, we have to wait until next year when we change all our original studies.
Oh.
Because we get to rewrite it all after this year. Yeah. We've enjoyed it.
So my daughter was in the Steiner's class this year, and I think I learned so much that she was coming home with. I mean, we're not Virginia people, we're from Pennsylvania, so we didn't know a lot of Virginia history, and every night at dinner she's telling us about things that she learned in school. Every night is tomorrow we'll get to learn about a new project, but we can't wait to hear about it. And the artist, now she just, that's all she wants to do is draw, and asks me to buy her things for drawing. And honestly, the last night of the parent night, you know, it was the second to last day of school, and I was just exhausted. And I'm like, can we just skip it? No, we have to go. And so we had to go. And she just, I'm one of the parents that's worried for fifth grade. Because it was just an amazing year.
It was amazing to us. I think it's a daunting task, and I don't necessarily suggest that everybody needs to jump off the cliff and do everything all at once. But we sat down and aligned our curriculum, which was our first step. We did that over the summer, the beginning of the summer. We were amazed by how much, we said, well, we have to do Virginia studies. Well, how are we going to line up science? How are we going to line up space and Virginia studies? And when we got to Native Americans and the early history of Virginia and the early history of the world, and all it all lined up. It was amazing how that science fit in with interlaces with the history so well, the math. You know, there were a few things that were a little contrived, but mostly we got that to line up very well. And it took a little work, and you really had to familiarize yourself with the standards.
But it shows that it can be done. Because I think a very natural reaction to the video we watched yesterday is, that's amazing and great, but they threw the standards out the window. They don't have to worry about it. How's this going to work in our county where I'm very glad we've got permission to just throw the standards out the window and do what we want? And it does work. You have to work harder. And things aren't always ideal. There's always a standard that might be contrived to sort of squeeze into something that you wouldn't want to do. But you can do it. And it's still very, very successful.
And
we were not sure that was going to happen at the beginning of the year, but we had a freak out moment in March. I think that we had a calendar that we made up in March. We're like, are we going to get it all done? And we planned out the rest of the year, and we said, okay, well, we're going to get it done, you know, the day before the test, but we'll get it done. And we had review time in there and everything. I mean, we did get it all done. There have been a lot of people as we've gone around talking about this. Well, you know, that's not going to work for ELL. That's not going to work for special ed. Well, that's not going to work for. And I think, you know, everything has to be changed and tweaked when you're dealing with different people. But a huge chunk of our language arts is explicit vocabulary instruction. Who is that bad for? You know, that's great for ELL. That's great for special ed. We didn't have any actual ELL. We had FLEP kids this year. It was their first year out of the program, and they did very well with it. I've heard we can't do this in primary grades, and I said, primary grades, you're already doing it almost. You know, you have some great units. Your research doesn't have to look like ours. You don't have to get on Chromebooks and do your research. You can go out into the courtyard and open up a pumpkin. You can't, you know, I mean, that's what primary research is going to look like. But you're closer there than I think a lot of the upper elementary school teachers are. So I think it's accessible to anybody. Oh, and we never got to say though, we did steal a bunch from Chrissy and Mr. Wood the other last year when you did your presentation. Some of our structure of our class meetings that we do, we took from some of the stuff we talked about last year. So, I do.